I run the Israeli Selenium meetups. So this talk actually started as a discussion where we talked about page objects, and everybody says they want to implement it in a different way. So I just put it in writing what people think they should do. And what I wanted to present to you is the questions that and the pros and cons for every decision you can make when you decide and you create your page object. Okay, so let's start. So about me, well, I did a lot of stuff. I always thought it was non-related to tests, but apparently everywhere I worked, it was test related, even with IBM. So it was, I helped the test team. The Cadence, that was the language specific for the hardware verification. And obviously I helped, I know a lot about web, but I thought nothing about testing. And I helped Wix with the test automation a bit, and then found out there's no UI verification tool. So I ended up in Apple Tools. They have a great UI verification tool. You should try it out. Now I'm with trying to solve the challenge that everyone wants to solve for the last 30 years, which is the recalled playback tool. So let's start. So I'm going to talk about page object, why and not, but and how to use how to remove all your sleeps. That's the source of all evils. There's a different talk about locators, so you should probably check that out. And we're not going to talk about retries. So, which you can see in single page applications, see it a lot in Angular. You should probably use more advanced techniques. So the page object is just a simple design pattern. So it's funny because what developers do, the architect usually, he takes the model of the application and he needs to transform it into a UI. And it's funny because now we have to take the UI and we actually want to transform it into the same model again as the user sees it. So it's almost the same. It resembles the model that the architect saw it in, that you have in the back end. But now you have to like reverse engineering. So what we're going to talk about is software design. How will you use? You use object, you use classes. People like to use it, so you get reuse using inheritance. Some people prefer delegation. You can use all that. So let's start with page object and see what it is. Everybody knows it by different names. When I started it at Wix, like 10 years ago, people called it drivers. There wasn't any documentation. And it's not just pages. It's not just a page for a specific page. Every component should have something that you, some kind of driver that you can interrogate the component have. And actually what you want to do is separate between the implementation and the model. You want to have it as a service. You expose a service actually, or the model, which you can interrogate and drive through. So that, well, I think someone says that Simon said that if you're using in your test, you're using the Selenium, so you're doing it wrong. So I hope I didn't misquote anyone. So we'll start with the basic login, which is very simple and kind of interesting. That's the thing, the Google login. And after you remove all the CSS parts that related, you basically get just two text boxes and a button. So, and usually people start with a test. It actually looks like this. You just, okay, if I want to do a login, I'll enter some text and to each text box, and then just click whatever I want. And now I'm going to, after I logged in, I'm going to try, I'm going to wait till something loads up, and I'm going to do some assertions. So usually every step is why you start in a state, you use stimuli to go to another step, and you do some assertions. So, okay, so Simon says no. please don't do that. So let's see what can we do. We want to split between the business logic, between what we're actually testing, the application itself, and remove and change it to the move to the side, all the implementation part. And I saw it in action at Wix. They asked me to help around with the test automation. The guy started out really, really bad. Now Wix has the best automation in Israel, probably. But there's great guys there. But they started out with exactly what we said you can't do. So what the first thing I did was, OK, let's separate. I wrote over the weekend interfaces for the entire application. And I gave it to the tester and said, OK, use those interfaces. Now you can write tests. You have the business logic. Everything a user can do, everything you can do with your click in your test, in your scenarios, you can write now. It's interfaces. But now give me 2 weeks, and I implemented the application so I can easily implement the drivers. So I separated between the business logic and the implementation. That worked out great. The tests were, after 2 weeks, the tests were the minimal the code they wanted to test it was over, and we implemented it. So that worked out great. So let's see how we can do that in exactly with the login page. We do want to have a log, something representing the login page, and make an action, a login, simple login action. But now the question starts. So when we do this presentation is in Java, but you can the same question applies to all, not just the static languages like C sharp. I think that the question is about architecture. So the same decisions is similar in PHP, Ruby, JavaScript. So what do you think you should, what do you think, maybe we should ask you guys. So what does the login has to return? Let's say the login brings us to the gallery page. So there's 2 options. Let's return void, or let's return the gallery page. Who says let's return void? Who says let's return the gallery page? OK, so let's start and go through all the options we have. So the first option is void, which means it has an advantage. So that's what you'll do. You'll do a login, but then you don't know where you are, and you have to wait till the page loads. And there's an advantage here. And the only advantage is it says, OK, the login deals with the login. That's it. He doesn't have to deal with anything else. So why should I deal with something, the return? Where should I go? Well, I'm the login. I don't know where I'm supposed to go. But it doesn't handle any of the other issues we want to know. Did the login succeed? Where are we now? Are we at the login? Is the login failed and we're back to the login? Are we at the gallery page? We don't know where we are. Is it ready? Should we wait more? So the second option, I don't think it's improved, but I probably should raise that. So it's a different option. The different option is let's return the gallery page. So when we get the nice part about it is that, OK, I return a gallery page, and now I can use it. Now, of course, with a small timeout. Don't worry, we'll deal with the timeout. So the source of evil for me when you start running tests is there's one thing is that's the random sleep. When you first write his own test or program, writes a sleep, but nobody should ever use sleep. So, but we'll get to that in a second. But the first question is, we need to find out there's an asynchronous. That's the difference between unit testing and end-to-end testing. Usually, is that you have asynchronous calls. You're doing the login. It's going to take some while. You're not sure how much. Maybe there's hundreds of VM on one machine, so it's going to take forever. So we're not sure. We need to deal with that. But the first thing we need to decide is where to put it. Should we keep it in exactly where it is right now in the test? Should we keep it in that side of the login? So let's see what we got. So the first option is, OK, let's add it to the login and before we return the gallery. And so we wait. The nice thing about it is that you get your test seems like synchronous code. It looks great. It looks like unit tests. You get, give me the login and do the login. And now I can do something on the gallery. So wow, it looks cool. Well, actually, but we if it's something, if we need to wait till the gallery is ready, maybe we shouldn't do that inside the login, because the login page doesn't know what's the gallery page. It's got nothing to do with this. So maybe the wait, if we want to wait for the page, well, let's give it a name, like wait for a page. Let's put in the gallery page and have the same code, the same sleep in the gallery page. So that could be a good option. And if we're back to the option one, that we have a login, and after we logged in, we can now ask the gallery page, like add a static method, and said, okay, wait for the gallery. Now it's gonna interrogate using the driver, it's gonna interrogate the page, the document, and find out when it's ready. The gallery page is the perfect place to put everything related to the gallery. And once it's done, it's gonna return an object, the gallery page object, an instance of gallery page, and we can move on. So that's a nice way to put it. And what we can do is we can combine two options, and in the login, when we want to return the gallery page, we can ask the gallery, okay, I want to return a new instance, so why don't you tell me when you're ready and give me an object and I'll return you. So the login does know where you're supposed to go. So maybe the login is a different, I chose the login because very, very simple, everybody knows it, but there's a lot of situations where the inside your page, you know exactly when you're going. So this is great. I'm not sure if the login is the perfect scenario for returning some return type. We'll get to that in a second. So here the login waits, and the login asks the gallery, tell me when you're ready, and I'll return you. And but then, okay, so if every page is asynchronously, so maybe we should add some conformance. I want every page to have some method. This forces the developers to implement such functions. So we have we can have every at the login, we can have at the gallery, we can have every component should have one. So we should probably have it at the base class and have things inherited and extended. But my computer says no. you cannot have overrides versus static methods. But what we can fix that very quickly if we just remove the static, so it won't be a static method. We'll create new objects and then tell them wait. So it's almost the same. But I think we can, in some languages, we can even improve that. Because for here, you see the gallery, the wait for page. It implements the wait for page signature, which is returning basic page. So that's what everyone does. But in Java, you have the flexibility to return something, even not just returning basic page, you can return something that extends it, and it's still considered not breaking the signature. So you can return a gallery page. So when you call gallery the gallery page, wait for page, it returns a gallery page. So, and this is another option. We'll see it in a few minutes. But this is a nice option too. Okay, just let's put in the constructor. If the same waiting, and it doesn't matter if it's waiting or if we saw wait for sleep, but we can use the constructor. And the first tip, I want to keep using the basic page. It's that common reuse, you're using it in inheritance. So if you have more methods, more things that is common to all pages, you just add it there. So we will reuse via inheritance. So people start asking, okay, how do I support different users and different pages? So we can see what we can do. So, okay, so if you want different users, so okay, let's add a user and a password. That could work, right? Sounds simple, but okay. Then so we get to the first challenge, and it's that. The login, we can log in with the correct password and then the wrong password. And should as you can see, the wrong password should lead me back to the login page, and a good password should lead me to the gallery page. So that's these two different places. So when you try to write this code, it's called overloading, and overloading gives you, when you have different signatures, you can use different methods, write different codes. But in Java, for overloading, it has to be the name or the parameter. So you can't use overload only with the return type. So you can't. This is going to give you an error. It's going to say, no, those are not three. Those are three different functions. You can't overload. So you're stuck. Then what you'll see in most cars is login as incorrect, login as admin. So different users get which point to different pages. You'll probably see this. So that's Java. So it won't happen. You can JavaScript or Ruby. You can do that. So that's the limitation. But the next question is, username and password. Why do I have to add? I don't want to use a username and password. And that depends on what you want to do. Because when you have the login page, the page object, you have two options. You have two different scenarios. You have one scenario that you use the login to get to the gallery page, and you want to test the gallery page. That's one thing. And there's a different scenario when you want to test the login. You want to test it with a bad username, a good username. So those are two different scenarios. Well, the first scenario, when you want to have it as a setup for another, for testing a different component, I don't need any params there, because I don't care you do the login. I just want to log in. I just want to get my component. So I don't care. I want it as simple as that. I want to have every developer doing the login page dot, and the ID will automatically say, okay, you have login. That's easy. That's it. Simple as that. And the implementation can vary from cookies to Google accounts and username, real user and password. I don't know. We don't care. But if we want to taste the actual page, the actual login page, so here we do want to have a different API. We do want to have the recommendation is usually, okay, had a method called login with username and password, but there are some people that prefer having references to the implementation, which is usually less recommended, but there's kind of people that do want to have this kind of thing so they can do like on hover effects or something to like the user, mimic the user and have it do something similar as they manually do it. So it depends. So should we put everything together? Because there we have the simple login and the straightforward one and the more complicated. So, okay, again, this is the login page, very, very simplified. So we have two methods, but you can have 20 methods for each one. So the question is, should we put it together? I guess the answer is yes. Yes, I do want to have it all together. That's all the code is related to this, to the page, to this login page. But if you want to prettify it, so if you want to make it simple, you can actually have two interfaces, the one that has the login, one that has the simplified logins, one that has that the more complicated way to interrogate the application and drive it. And you can have one method to bring you one from one to another. And the implementation, actually, they can be both in the same class that we have interfaces for. So you can use interfaces to expose only the simple API, and if someone wants to, you'll get the more collaborative API, but he can move that only if he needs to. So you can have like a convention getting the driver, and every component will have a driver as well as the simplified API. So when you start implementing page objects, you'll probably find things like you'll try to get reference to an element. So usually you start when getting a reference when you want to use it. So in this example, only when you click the, when you want to do the login, you get the reference and then use it. But usually you'll need it in several methods. So you say, okay, I'll put in the constructor. Then I have reference and I can use it a million times. So you probably had added to the constructor, and then, but then you notice, okay, it's really repeating itself, and every element I need to find in the page is actually repeating itself. So is there anything I can do to remove all this glue code? And actually, yes, there's a page factory. Does anyone here uses page factory? Yeah, cool. So page factory gives you exactly that. You can tell it, okay, initialize everything for me. I just have web elements, and all I want to do is I want to have references to the page. So it's even you can even simplify that and add it to, you remember the constructor, we said you can add the weighting to the constructor. So if we do all the waiting till the page is ready, the code for the login at the constructor, okay, after it's done, we can call the page factory and tell it to init itself on us. And that's it. We have everything ready. So sounds great, and actually what the page for some people that don't know exactly what happens, what's the magic behind it, it looks for the names. If you have a web element named email, he uses reflection and he says, okay, you have a field member named email, and he tries to find an element at the document with that ID. If he doesn't find it, he's looking for with an attribute named name that the value is email, and so on. So what happens if we have, this is the real example from Google that they use, and the name is Q. So that's, nobody wants a field member named Q. The R&D manager is going to, the code review team, we're going to kill us. So they added the annotation. So you can say, okay, I wanted to, it's called on the page, it's called in the document, it's called Q, but when I use it, I want to call it search box. So I just want to call it differently. And of course, it could be prettified because there's a shorthand version. So just find by name equals to Q. So, and you have, they support the ID and tags, and you can write your own custom annotations. That's the best part. You have different ways to find elements. You can write your own code, because everyone's code is different. Maybe yours is extremely, extremely different. And well, as for assertion, there's a strict recommendation. It's only one slide. And there's a strict recommendation that people tend to go with, so adding it to the test or adding it in some batch of class so you can reuse it. But I did see it in people still use it in page objects, though most the recommendation, best practices, just add it inside their test or in insertion classes that you add. But the just one more thing I wanted to ask was, how do you avoid the random sleeps? Well, and there's I promised I'll get rid of it because nobody should use random sleeps. So there's a few, don't worry, don't try even try to Google the names, I just made them up. And there's a couple of options you can use. I think those are the most common four. It's four because the coordinator has like two options. And the no smoke without fire, that means that that has to happen before. So usually you don't have, if you have smoke, so probably you had a fire before. So it's a before relation, it happens before. So usually you wait for an element that you know that loads last. You talk to the dev team and say, okay, which element loads last? And if I wait for that element, I know the entire page is ready. So that's the first common that people use. There's the take your time idea that you use that just, let's try to click it. If it doesn't work, let's try it again. If not, it doesn't work, let's try it again. And we'll do that until there's a timeout. So I'm taking my time. I'm going to try it like a busy wait. And well, at Selenium added the implicit wait. So it got easier. And people usually start with this, and then they get bugs. So I usually don't recommend using it. And the coordinate, that means I want to have someone at the application side tell me, or at least I can find out. I want to sync everything between me and the application, not just use wait for random elements. So what you want to do, you have two options. The one is use the the first option is I want to wait for I want to send wait for an event to happen. So we can do it in two options. There's a we can when I use in the code in the test what it actually does the implementation we would probably use asynchronously. You can inject JavaScript to the document, but we can add run asynchronously JavaScript. So we inject JavaScript that runs in a loop and checks this for something to happen. When he finds out something's okay, when something happened, it can be either he checks for some kind of state. When you get to that state, he calls the callback and tells me, okay, you can move on. So we on the testing side, it's completely synchronous. It's just saying because we're waiting till he'll send the callback. So usually you have the execute async script, which is very simple. It's that you write something that runs code. But what it means, it runs JavaScript code that runs it runs a callback. So it looks very, very simple. And it really is simple. And but there's a small gotcha you have to remember that they provide. You shouldn't wait for the callback as a name. You should probably wait for it. The callback method is the last method. That's what they promised. This is the last method. So you should probably use this kind of code. Okay, find the argument, take the last argument, and this is the callback, and when you're done, when you get to the specific state, just let us know. Let the Selenium back know. So we're done. So, I'll tell you what I don't like about this is that you have if you use Java and then you have to write JavaScript code and you have to ask the developer, okay, come and write in my code and JavaScript and put it inside the. So there's good editors like WebStorm and IntelliJ that can syntax highlight JavaScript, but it's far from perfect. And the question is, can we do something that we can ask the developers to let's make a contract, very simple contract. It's going to take three lines of code for me and three lines of code for you, but we'll have a contract, and then I can know whenever you're ready, whenever you switch the pages. And it's actually three lines of code I'm going to show you. So what do you want to do is, in your code, you say, I want to wait for some test event inside the application. And the guy writing the app, in my case, a lot of the time that was me, I would emit an event, says, OK, I'm ready. I'm done. And what it looks like is something like this. There are two methods. And the implementation is rather easy because you use it before you return. We remove the sleep and add a wait for test event. And the implementation would actually be very, very simple. We usually, when you write apps, you have the application somewhere. But you can have another diff, only not in production, just in testing. You can have another element for testing. And people can add elements there. So, and you're asking me why? Because What's the best about the best thing about Element? What about Selenium? What can you do? What's the best thing? The easiest thing to do in Selenium? Finding what? Elements. Wait for elements. We got that in Selenium. So you can tell the developer on the other side when you're if you want instead of submitting an event. So I said event. I need to add JavaScript callback. So no, just add an element, and I'll wait for that element to exist. So if we have the div with the element with the ID test, so It's very easy for us developers. That's the entire framework. That's it. We need to wait to an element. We're waiting for a gallery-ready event. So we know that the developer will add some gallery-ready element to inside the test. So that's easy to find out. This is the code. That's it. And once I'm done, let's remove it. And the, on the other hand, the developer just has to add just one more line on his side with, when he's done, when he knows. The developers always know when it's ready. They know. Trust me, they know. The only thing they had to add is just add one simple method. And usually there's a lot of frameworks right now, like AngularJS and Ember. They have routers and which change from state to state. And usually they even give you hooks to when changing states. So you can even usually add something that automatically adds this. You won't even need this single line. So when they change the state, they automatically add this element. And the implementation, of course, is very, very, very easy. It's like two liners. Okay, if I'm not testing, if I'm in production, I probably don't want to do anything. But there's a more pretty implementation, but this is easiest to explain. If I'm not testing, then return. But if I'm testing, I should probably add this as an event. Add an element with gallery ready as a class. And that's it. So I guess what I want to tell you guys is that this is a discussion. This is not, you saw there's always two options. And I guess you should decide every time, ask yourself, why do I make the decision? What's the pro and con for every decision I make? And the best thing about meetups and the conferences is that you talk to other people and they show you what they are using. People here use, there's a lot of more techniques. So there's some people use page objects as static methods. They don't use the objects at all. Say, what are the chances I'll have? Two galleries and one page. So there's a lot of techniques, and I think the best thing to do is, one, talk to each other, and the second thing is when you do something, talk about it. Blog, is Dave here? He's talking a lot, and he has a blog, and he keeps on adding common use cases, and I think he has a book right now. He just added everything together and added lots of more things that you can do with the commons in Selenium. So what I really think that you should do is just talk to each other, and if someone has any questions, now is the best time. So. Yes. Okay. So the question is about assertions. Why is it recommended not to have the assertion in the page object? Usually, when people try to use page objects, they want to use it as a way to interrogate the object, the component in front of them. Usually, it's component. So it doesn't have to say something about the business logic. So the page objects, they deal with implementation. They know you, okay. So I have a business logic, the API, which means A, B, and C for login. I'm gonna implement it. So you implement the login, but there's a lot of cases when the business logic you want to have on the testing side. So that's the business logic on one side, but it's not something that there's a must. The whole question here is, every language, we don't have to use even objects. Everything we want to test, we can write it without object, without classes. The whole thing is just design patterns. Yeah, how can I write something that will be easier to maintain, easier to write, so every time something fails or not, I know exactly where to change that or where to add it. I want to make something very simple and find out. I don't have to think, where should I put it? So you want to have design patterns that go back, and then you want to focus on what's important, the testing, the business logic. That's different between every application. And not thinking, OK, should I put the timer here and here and spend so much time? So it's a recommendation between just because there's a, you try to separate between the business logic and implementation. So yes. My question is, why won't you know? Because after you landed somewhere, you will find out. So you have some code that find that his job is actually finding out which page am I on. Maybe this code should ask, oh, the gallery, is that your page? And he said no, and then he'll ask the login page, is that do you recognize, is this login page? If he says okay, yeah, that's the login page, so he says I'll return the same one. Those types are tricky. So in statically typed languages, you can have the base object and then having casting, but that usually sucks. So what you do usually, that's why people use the void convention, returning void, and then in business logic, just trying to find out, there's having another system, another component that his job is finding out whose fault is that? Yeah, who's now? Who? Okay, it's the gallery. Okay, I should probably call that.
Another question is related to
page. So that's what I said in the beginning, because things are changing. There's not lots more single page application right now, so that's why I asked in the Q&A as well, is there going to be some support for the retries? Because every the page apps usually saved you a lot of code, so now you have to use something, you have to go back to the old way and try to use it as you go along, and usually you can try to do is wrapping the elements with your own element, and that makes the tries, and if it doesn't work, it tries to find the element again. So you can have such a custom web element, your own web element that does the retries. So, the funny thing is that everybody keeps doing that. So that's what I hope that something like that will enter Selenium, and everybody can reuse the same code. So that's where we have the name. So we should probably add that as a request, and you should probably give it a thumbs up or something. So no, I see it a lot, and there's the stale exceptions happen more and more. And because you see, there's frameworks now like Angular that if you misuse it, even if you don't go to another page, even if you change the filter, you have like a filter that filter the items. If you use it, in a bad way, which beginners do that. And you can have the same element. It looks the same, but it's not the same element because it actually does a refresh, which is bad for their performance, of course. But it has effects on the test. So you should probably ask them, can you use? There's of course the Angular can be improving. There's a track by. There's a lot of things you can do to improve that. But I until that day happens, yeah, we should. We need to do something on our own. So I guess I hope we'll do something that's very nice that Selenium will pull in. So, OK. Yes. Sorry? The web element, we're talking. Yes? What's the question again? Yeah. Are you answering his question? Well, no, is there, you know, if you do see something, someone having a pretty solution that can be used, so if someone knows already, so let me know. Okay. but there weren't any, everyone writes their own code, and that's something that we should not do. Yes. So you're talking about the option, the numbers, the second option, that if I return an object, so what happens, it's a similar question, that what if we should return different options? So there's no clear decision on how to implement it for now. So I see a lot of people just returning a base class and not using some kind of someone that they can ask later. And it depends. And it usually in not statically languages, statically typed languages, you don't have that that dilemma. So by the way, does anyone here uses JavaScript as the binding language? Wait, woohoo! Well, it's funny, I really hope that it will catch on, because people, the developers themselves, use JavaScript, and so maybe if the testing would be in JavaScript, there would be, could be better communication between the developer and the test automation. And so I do starting to see some improvement on that side. Anyone here knows about Protractor as well? So, and the Protractor is based on Selenium, but it gives a little bit better API, because the small difference is for better API just for Angular, because Angular has some things that it waits for and does, there's something called dirty checking, and it's called asynchronously, so you usually have to wait for some stuff, and he does it for you, so that's a nice implementation in JavaScript for AngularJS, so. So guys, thank you very much. Thank you.